Oh, Rosemary, I love you. And Bill and his friends will be right back.
I hate that song. Hate that song. I wish somebody would knock on the door with my new Flynn Whitman album.
Your new Slim Whitman Christmas album.
Oh, this is great. I've waited 4 to 6 weeks for delivery on this thing. I'm glad I sent in my 798 or else.
That's great. I've delivered millions of them.
Millions?
Millions of them.
Gee, you must be tired. You got a couple minutes?
I'm tired. I'll come right on.
Hey, why don't you come here? I'll pour you a hot toddy and play a cut from my new Slim Whitman Christmas album.
Hey, that's great. I'd like to hear
it. He's my hero. How about La Paloma Blanca?
What do you mean, Paloma Blanca? That's not in this Christmas album. I have a better idea.
Got a better idea?
Yeah, I've got a better idea.
Shoppers, bright window displays, children are carefully counting the days. Gifts for the giving, no matter the cost, nobody notices something's been lost. Silent night is now just a sweet song. Angels are singing, no one sings along. Once simple shepherds heard news of a king. Such wise men, yet no gift we bring. Where is the Christ in Christmas? Let us make room in the end. Where is the Christ in Christmas? Christmas belongs to him. Turn back the years to the old holidays, families and firesides and hearts all ablaze. Mary and Joseph and one holy child, giving with love in the old-fashioned style. Where is the Christ in Christmas? Let us make room in the air.
Last year, 1,400,000 TV viewers ordered this man's albums and tapes and made him a new American recording star.
No modest darling, but my love.
And now, to fill the tremendous demand, we proudly offer a brand new album by Slim Whitman, the international star whose heart-touching voice has now captured America.
Making me.
Here is all the magic of Slim Whitman, the star who had the number one record in England for more weeks than even Elvis and the Beatles.
Think I'll go somewhere and cry myself to sleep. If you love me, let me know. If you don't, then let me go.
Since you've gone, the star. In the sky, down the river of golden dreams.
I know your time.
just for you. This all-new Giant Record Treasury is only $7.98. Complete tape collection is only $9.98. Not sold in any store. Order yours now.
To get this beautiful all-new treasury.
Ladies and gentlemen, our special guest star, Slim Whitman.
When the sun shines on the mountain and the night is on the run, it's a new day, it's a new way, and I climb up to the sun. I can feel the morning sunlight, I can smell the new mown hay, I can hear God's voices calling for a golden skylight way. Una paloma blanca, I'm like a bird in the sky. Una paloma blanca, over the mountains I fly, no one can take my freedom away. I had my share of bluesing, and they put me on a chain. Oh, they tried to break my power, I can still feel the pain.
Really, it's so great to finally hear you sing that entire song.
You know, that's been, if I had to pick 9 months of the last 32 and a half years that has been the greatest, I would say the last 9 months.
Is it all from the TV record?
All from the TV record album and Channel 17 out of Atlanta and all that sort of thing.
But Slim, you've been around, you said, for 32 years, so this is a whole new career for you.
Yeah, I've had a couple of careers. I started in 1948, the first big records were 1952, early part of 52. Then there was a kind of a lull in the United States. It was good overseas, but lull in the United States. Then in the 70s, it came back a little, and here in 1980, it has really boomed.
You know, all of a sudden become a giant megastar. How do you handle all that?
Well, it's if I was a new fella, if I was a young guy, it might be a little tough. But now I appreciate it. I'm kind of awed by it that the kids come up and say, hey, I like what you're doing. I say, what do you like about it? I like your suit. I like your Una Paloma Blanca. And the older people had wondered where I had drifted off to, and they're buying them. It's a new ball game, but back, I love it. I'm a ball player, you know.
Back and bigger than ever.
Yeah,
I like can't it. Thank you enough for having us on the show.
I enjoyed it. It's my pleasure.
Thank you, Doc. My first guest tonight, interesting story. Rather an interesting little preface to the introduction of my next guest. I like music. I listen to a lot of music. But I, until some months ago, was not really familiar with Slim Whitman, as a lot of people in this country were, but he was very popular in England. And they ran a commercial on late night television. I think it came out of some of the satellite stations. I know one from Atlanta for sure. Advertising Slim Whitman albums. And people said, my God, who's Slim Whitman? And he's kind of caught on. And in case you missed the commercial, we're going to run the commercial for you. This is the one that is seen all over the country and really brought Slim Whitman to the attention of a lot of people in this country. Bobby, you want to run that? This international recording star had the number one record in England for more weeks than any singer in history, even Elvis and the Beatles.
Rosemary.
And now, for the first time on American TV, we proudly offer the fabulous hits of Slim Whitman, the man voted number one international male artist in England 4 years in a row. Here is all the magic of Slim Whitman, the international star who has sold 31 million records.
Vaya con Dios, my darling.
All the songs that touch people's hearts the most are in this album, and I hope you'll let them touch your heart too.
Have I told you lately that I love you?
Whitman, All My Best. This giant record treasury is only $7.98. Complete tape collection is only $9.98. Not sold in any store. Order yours now.
Anyway, that's the commercial that played all over the country. And we start talking about it, and people recognize the name. And I said, hey, you know, it's only fair we ask Slim Whitman to come on the Tonight Show. Would you welcome, please, Slim Whitman.
Dreams come true a few kisses ago. I remember you. You're the one who said I love you true. Didn't you know? Fell like the rain out of the blue. My life is through, and the angels ask me to recall the thrill of them all. Then I will tell them I remember you. The rain out of the blue. My life is through, and the angels ask me to recall the thrill of them all. Then I will tell them I remember.
Yeah, welcome. We got to do a commercial here first, Slim, then we'll come back and talk a little bit. We'll be right back. We are back. Thank you, Doc. We're talking to Slim Whitman. You know, you've been in the business a few years, but you kind of really snuck in the back door in this country.
Yeah, it's kind of strange. I started in March 1948, which is about 33 years ago. And every year I made records. I made them in Nashville or Chicago or in London somewhere, but the United States, it seems, if you found one, you had to thumb through them, you know, to find them.
Right.
And but England, the rest of the world was great.
Yeah, I've noticed in the commercial they talk about the top of the charts.
Yeah, it says first time on American TV.
And in the Guinness Book of Records, sure enough, you held the British charts, top of the British charts for a record 11 weeks.
Yeah.
And yet you really weren't that well known in this country.
Well, it started here, really. In 1952, I had A Million Seller of Indian Love call. And I had several, in fact, I had Rosemary, who was a big hit here before there.
Right.
But then it kind of leveled off, and I went overseas, and they held on to it a little bit longer than the United States did.
Now, this campaign that was on television with the albums has been sensational, because I've read that you're playing concerts all over, you're doing colleges, you're doing back to high schools, and
busy as can be. Started, really. And if I had to pick any one thing in 33 years, it has been the highlight, the biggest thing in Whitman career. It had to be last year. And it had to be the commercial that some people laugh at, but they buy it.
Yeah.
See?
That's the name of the game.
Yeah.
How many? Now, you don't have to tell me if you don't want to. How many albums did they sell?
Well, it's 2 million and rising.
2 million?
And rising, yeah.
Rosemary. You got a song you want to... Oh,
yes.
2 million. That's, and Ryan, still going up.
It's still selling.
You've got a good voice. You slide in and out of that falsetto.
Out of trouble. I get in and out of trouble.
Yeah, but all of a sudden you... That's not easy to do. You get into that high register.
I think it's something you have to be born with. My son is a singer. In fact,
it's like yodeling, isn't it? You can't learn it.
Yeah, he's a singer, but he doesn't yodel. See, right. Even though I'm his dad, he can't yodel. It's a thing you're born with, and... in fact, when I started, I had my first hit record. They said, "Why don't you start a yodel school?" I didn't know how to start it.
Right. Well, somebody asked you how to yodel, Slim. What do you tell them?
Well, I just say, "Oh, that's it. That's all I know." See.
And I know if I do that, it's going to sound ridiculous because
that's here.
But you have it clear back in here, don't you?
Yeah, it's down here somewhere.
No, I can't. There's no way.
It's down in here somewhere. I don't know where it comes from. I just, when I think a word needs it, I go into it.
Slide right into it.
And then that's the way it happens.
Yeah, I'm really glad for your success. It's nice to see something like somebody who started a career and then all of a sudden have a resurgence of it.
Well, it's good to be it's good to be everywhere. And what makes me real happy is the fans that have stayed with me all these years, even though they didn't know where I was.
They knew you were somewhere, but not where, huh?
Yeah, they're actually coming up to me and saying, "We know you're happy, but we're just as happy as you are."
And that's great.
And that's really great. That's what it's all about. Yeah. And the little kids coming up, "Could we get your autograph?"
That's nice.
I said, "Man,
You bet.
Yeah.
I know you're going to do it. You can do Rosemary for us tonight?
Oh, yeah, I'm going to do it.
Would you do it for us?
If I can.
Absolutely.
All right.
It's all yours. Thank you, Slim. All yours.
of Mr. Ray Charles and the pure country gold of Slim Whitman.
And starring...
Hey, everybody. We got someone here that's real special to us. He sold 800 zillion albums, and he's England's number one country star. America loves him, too. One of the most unique voices in country music, the fabulous Slim Whitman.
I'm glad.
Bird shack in the mountain, bravely fighting the battle of time. Is that dear one who's weathered life's sorrow? It's that silver-haired daddy. If I could recall all the heartaches, dear old daddy, I paused you to bed. If I could erase those lines from your face and bring back the gold your head. If God would but grant me the power just to turn back the pages of time, I'd give all I own if I could but atone that silver-haired daddy of mine. If God would but grant me the power just to turn back the pages of time, that silver hair, daddy of mine. I'd give all if I could get a tone to that silver hair, daddy of mine.
George, have you seen that new French film at the movie house?
I have, and it was disgusting.
Was?
Yeah, even more disgusting the second time I've seen it.
Well, ain't it reassuring to know that our government is finally solving the unemployment problem? They just hired 5,000 people.
To do what?
To count up how many people are out of work. Hee-haw salutes my hometown of Middleburg, Florida. Population 3,000.
I know I should be happy I met you, though you were ill-tempered and queer. Last night you told me I should forget you. Slim Whitman is the voice you must hear. Where, oh, where are you tonight? Why did you leave me here all alone? I searched the world over and thought I'd found true love. You met another and you were gone.
Lord have mercy.
Sam Whitman.
I remember you. You're the one who made my dreams come true. A few kisses ago, I remember you. You're the one who said I love you true. Didn't you know? I remember to a distant bell and stars that fell like the rain out of the blue. Tell them I remember you. I remember to a distant bell and stars that fell like the rain out of the blue. Tell them I remember. Tell them I remember. Tell them I remember you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Very nice, very nice.
Wasn't that a beautiful studio audience? Yeah. Really on top of the country.
And some of them this morning.
Where do I even have you here? How do you keep your voice in shape?
Well, really, it's not a plan. I'm not a drunkard. I'm not a smoker. And it's just things that come natural if the voice is like feet.
I don't like that. If you say you don't drink and don't smoke, I'm trying to say, what do you do? But I'm not going to do that. Yeah, something that's always fascinated me, Slim. We've worked together a million times. Mm-hmm. And I know you love to sing. And you get out in front of an audience, you put on a great show and entertain. You have a beautiful voice. And I wonder where you found the vision. The song, I think, that launched your career was the song, Indian Love Call.
Well, you know, 52.
Yeah, I like songs, and I often wonder.
Don't you love me?
Well, I might do that, thank you. But I was wondering, where did you get a song like Indian Love Call? Where did you find that song?
Well, it was just when the first record I had was Love Song to Waterfall, which was in the song that was a little more western than Indian Love Call, but the sign we had in Love Song to Waterfall is what we were looking for. And so we got into standard books, and man came in the love call, and I heard it.
It was an old song.
Yeah, it was old. In fact, it's way back. In fact, some people now have never heard my record either. Think it's lost in that age and that night. But it was something that kind of fit in with what we were doing, and we did it. And it was a good one.
So, well, we're glad to have you on Top Goes the Country this week in your left-handed guitar picking and your beautiful singing. Here's a right-handed singer, Charlie McCoy, maybe one of those guys. Hey, here's a gentleman and a scholar, and I'm happy to have him on the show this week. Would you give a nice round of applause to the inimitable Slim Whitman, and I remember you. Have little Sue Powell. Here's Slim Whitman. Slim, come in here. Oh, that's it. Hey, listen, we really enjoyed having you on the show, and congratulations on being America's latest heartthrob.
How about
great gentleman, Slim Whitman? Sue, thank you, honey, for coming.
Thank you,
Tim. And we're going to be back next week with a phenomenally fantastic show on Top Goes the Country. It's going to be great. Have a ride to you.
They laughed when this commercial first hit the screen. They're still laughing. And so is the man who made it. Slim Whitman, the king of mail order music, is laughing all the way to the bank.
The first time on American TV.
If you haven't seen or heard his TV commercial, you are part of a select minority. He's a yodeling tenor who's been making records for 34 years, and he's sold 50 million of them. He's right up there with Elvis, the Beatles, and Bing Crosby. He's Slim Whitman, and he's a king of mail order music. But who is Slim Whitman?
Slim Whitman, who is he?
Well, there's two things at once. He's a terrible singer, and he appeals to everybody.
Slim, gotta be at the studio in 10 minutes.
I gotta go make some money.
And people said, my God, who's Slim Whitman? And he's kind of caught on. And in case you missed the commercial.
This international recording star had the number one record in England for more weeks than any singer in history, even Elvis and the Beatles. And now, for the first time on American TV, we proudly offer the fabulous hit of Slim Whitman, the man.
How many albums did they sell?
Well, it's 2 million and rising.
2 million
books. And rising, yeah.
It blows me.
Albany, New York, and Slim's in town for a four-night stand.
Well, what am I? It's in film.
In the lean years, the mid-60s through most of the 70s, Slim made $750 a night when he sang. And he didn't sing often in the United States.
I'm like a bird in the sky.
But he did sing in England, where the critics hated him, the fans loved him. His Rosemarie topped the pop music charts for 11 straight weeks, a record not even the Beatles touched. Now Slim makes a minimum of $12,500 a night when he sings.
All the songs that touch people's hearts the most are in this album, and I hope you'll let them touch your heart too.
When I did the commercial in Pittsburgh, I saw the playback. I said, I don't even know what I came up with for. It didn't excite me at all.
Surprise.
If I had to pick any one thing in 33 years that has been the highlight, the biggest thing in Whitman career, it had to be last year. And it had to be the commercial that some people laugh at, but they buy it.
Yeah. That's the name of the game.
Slim fans are devoted, dedicated, and loyal. The critics are not.
You know, I've been all over the world, and there is some good entertainment in the world. But it seems there's one fellow who doesn't think so. He's in one of these papers here.
And Bernie Runyon would say, his voice is worse than you expect. Because his records are terribly well engineered, but his voice is not. One of the appeals that Slim has, that he's an old-fashioned, out-of-date singer, singing to old-fashioned, out-of-date people.
My name is Slim Whitman, and I'm here to say, stay tuned to the radio coming your way. You'll hear the latest they'll play on the radio.
The latest from Slim Whitman on FM Country, GNA.
Falling in love with.
I can't see where anyone would take Slim. that seriously. Slim doesn't take Slim that seriously. That's why he's such a wonderful character. I rather like him as a person. It's his music I can't stand.
Some 30 years ago. And that's what people seem to want right now. They want to look back and reminisce the good old days or something, good old songs, and that's what it is. Yeah. But tonight, I'm going to turn loose with you tonight.
Good.
Our voice is getting limber, so tonight, watch out.
Good.
I've read all kind of write-ups in the past year and a half. Who is this guy in our bedroom?
Have I told you, lady, that I love you?
Yes, Virginia, there really is a Slim Whitman. And in view of all that, I said, when I come into Albany, there's going to be a crowd to meet me. I got off the plane, there was one little lady. She was nice. I think her name was Annie. I talked quite a while to Annie. I said, Annie, it's good talking to you. I said, it's good talking to you too, Hank.
Mm-hmm. Bad singer. Great dresser.
Oh, sure, he's good.
What is that? Mustache? Is that a guy?
Slim Whitman. He's good. I think he's campy. Very campy.
And what makes me real happy is the fans that have stayed with me all these years, even though they didn't know where I was.
They knew you were somewhere, but...
I'll belong to you.
You wouldn't have to have a pen, would you?
And I was one of the ones that said, oh, that was Slim Whitman.
Did it prove? If you're a nice guy, you can't hide it.
How about that?
remember that.
But this one writer said, I can't understand this guy. I can't understand the people keep coming to see this guy, but he's not that great.
I saw your TV commercial. I'm screaming to the nurse, give me a pen, give me a pen.
Only thing it can be, he walks on stage. It seems when he says, how to
Million Seller, 1954 was the second million selling record, Rosemary. And then along came Elvis. Then a little bit later, along came the Beatles, and the whole world was changed. And
why did you change around with it?
I'm not a rock and roll singer, and I knew it. And I wouldn't join him. Can't let them join him. I wouldn't do it. I just wrote it out.
Ladies and gentlemen, the man you've been waiting for in 6 weeks for delivery on, Slim Whitman!
Atlanta. And a new generation of Whitman fans are ready.
Kids would go for Slim, except that it's a hoot.
Another record.
Slim? Hey, Slim. You guys can do it?
Turn me on, that's all. Just turn me on.
Christmas Carol, a sure seller. Right from his lips into your living room, out of your pocketbook, into his bank account.
So he's a millionaire. And he don't need no money.
Slim's agent, Billy Deaton.
From 1965 to like 1978, his career in America had just gone to pot. You couldn't give him away here. Nobody wanted him. You know, so like an old car. And
board as a donor for the fair.
When Slim has his estate in
first heard this man when I saw his commercials on television. I went out and bought the album. Actually, I sent in for the album. And when I got it, I just fell in love with it. I went out and I bought every single album I could find of his. And he is now one of my favorite singers. It is a great pleasure and honor for me to present to you Slim Whitman.
Thank you very much, Andy. It's a real pleasure to be on Midnight Special.
Well, it is great. I just want to thank you for coming here. I can't believe that I'm meeting you, because all I've seen is pictures of you and on TV, and now I'm meeting you in person. It's unbelievable. And I wonder, what song are you going to sing for us now?
It's a song I did years ago. I Remember You.
Okay, well, let's hear it. Thank you.
Thank you. My dreams come true, a few kisses ago. I remember you. You're the one who said I love you. Didn't you know?
One of the things I really love about when I listen to you sing is when you make your voice go up high like that. What is that called?
Well, it's a falsetto. It's a thing I've always had. In 32 years I've been singing, it's been perfected down through the years. But you mean this? I remember to a distant bell and stars that fell. You mean that?
Yeah.
That's it. Do it.
Oh, okay. Okay. I remember to
I like it.
The distant bell and stars that fell out of the blue. There's one song, I mean, there's a lot of songs I like that you sing. There's one especially that just I've been playing the record over and over again. I really love it. Love it. And I don't know if you could just do it on the spot like this, because, you know, I don't know if the band would be prepared, but it's called That Silver-Haired Daddy of Mine.
Oh, do you think I love you it. Could I grew up with it. I
could sing you sing it now?
I can sing it now.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
vine-covered shack in the mountains, bravely fighting the battle of time. Is that dear one who's weathered life's sorrow? It's that silver-haired daddy of mine. If I could recall all the heartache, dear old daddy, I've called you to bed. If I
would like to present you with one of my favorite singers in the whole world. Seriously. Here is Slim Whitman to sing his new single, When.
Sitting alone by the seaside, tasting the salt and the breeze, I see the lights of the fishing boats dancing all over the waves of the sea. Whispering voice of the ocean, tell me your secrets tonight. Take me away on a voyage of dreams in the night. In the night, when comes the day, I'll stop searching. When comes the day, I'll be free. When will my star start to rise? Maybe it never be.
co-host from Dallas, Lee McCluskey. And their guest, Elkie Summer. Comedian Johnny Dart. Former boxing champ, the Raging Bull, Jake LaMotta. Country music star, Slim Whitman. And now, here's the star of the show, Mike Douglas.
You know, during the last 8 years, through the use of television commercials, our next guest has become the rage of mail-order music, having sold millions, millions of records, yodeling his way through many gold albums. Here are the sounds of Slim Whitman. Welcome, Slim.
I remember you. You're the one who made my dreams come true a few kisses ago. I remember you. You're the one who said I love you true. Didn't you know? I remember too a distant bell and stars that fell like the rain out of the blue.
Slim, I've read this fabulous story. I've been seeing the commercials on television, as everyone has, and I read this fabulous story. Was it a Newsweek or Time?
Well, it's been a Newsweek, Old Week, and the whole bit.
And you've sold how many copies of that album?
The last I heard was in between 1.8 million and 10 million.
It's closing in on the 2 million.
Yeah, it's right at 2 million.
Slim, these are all real diamonds, then.
Oh, yeah.
Huh? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's no sense.
Yeah. Can I ask you something? Because I've heard a rumor, and I don't usually pry and do.
But you are now.
Well, no, I don't want to know, because it's incredible, because I know that some of the top recording artists, I know what they get as far as royalties concerned per album, and I heard that you got $2 an album. Is that true?
I hope so.
Would you tell me? You know, obviously, what you're getting. Am I close? Am I in the vicinity?
You could be...
Am I in the neighborhood?
You could be a little off.
Not far, though, right?
I'm not too far. Maybe a dollar and a half or somewhere around there.
You don't need this show, do you? How did the idea come up of you doing selling these records on television?
Well, really, it wasn't my idea. It was leased by Suffolk Marketing out of New York. They had a hunch with a guy that could do a yodel, and they came to me in Florida and said, would you help us do the commercial? And I'm not a television guy. As a matter of fact, I'd just soon be fishing. But
you won't believe this, but I'd rather be fishing.
Yeah. But anyway, I'm also a fellow that never give an answer today. I'll call you tomorrow.
Good for you.
And
you stay out of trouble that way, don't you?
It gives you time to think about it. And in the meantime, my son, who is here, Byron, is out here somewhere holding down the fort while I'm out here. And the wife said, what can you lose? Why don't you go up and do the commercial? And I took the advice of my family, really, and went to Pittsburgh and did
the commercial.
The commercial for Suffolk Packaging.
And now, how long has that taken to sell all those albums we just mentioned?
Well, it came on December 1979.
Just a little over a year.
Yeah, inside of a year, it was well into 2 million albums.
How many records have you sold all told through your career?
Over 50 million.
You know what was, Elkie, you'll appreciate this. This man's had the kind of a career where you became a big hit in Europe before America, didn't you?
It's the fourth career now,
in
really.
England, wasn't it?
Yes, England.
England has been very good to me.
Yes.
When everything was slack in other spots, England was buying records.
And did you make appearances over there?
Oh, yeah. I made my first appearance, England, 1956. I played 2 weeks at the London Palladium. I was a guy almost off of the farm, really going into the Palladium.
Are you a farm boy?
Well, I'm a guy from the country, yeah.
Yeah.
I have a place in the country where I relax, and as a matter of fact, I've blocked off July already.
Where in Florida? Where in Florida?
Out of Jacksonville.
Oh, sure.
As a matter of fact, Middleburg is south of Jacksonville. Yeah. That's where...
Beautiful country.
Where my acres are.
Yeah. You also had a gold record in Africa.
Had a gold record in Africa this year.
What was it? What tune?
30 Greatest Love Songs.
It's an album, then.
It's an album in Africa, and it went gold in Africa.
Now, is it the same in those countries? Do you have to sell as many copies?
No.
To get a gold album in America, it has to be a half a million.
It has to be a half a million.
It has to exceed a half a million albums. And how many is it in places like Africa?
In Africa, I think it's about 50,000.
And how about 100,000 in Germany?
100,000.
How about England? England is what?
England is close to America.
It's about a half a million.
It's close to America, yeah.
Do you believe this all? All that's what's happening?
Well, it awes me. Like this morning in the hotel here where I was eating breakfast, some kids came up and they said, could we have your autograph? And I said, where are you from? They said, Ohio. And they go to high school there and they have a big fan club in Ohio.
That's
wonderful. And I started questioning it, and I said, did you see, we saw this commercial. Una Paloma Blanca was their favorite, the one I opened with.
Oh, for hell's sake.
And I talked with them quite a while, and there's fan clubs all over the country. In the colleges, they tried to run me for president. I didn't know what to do with it, so we didn't know. But it's been fun all the way. It's the biggest, I've been singing 33 years. It's the biggest year I've ever had in show business.
Do you really enjoy the business? Because from what you have said, I kind of get the feeling that you'd rather just chuck it all and go fishing.
Well, up to this commercial came on, I was looking at retirement. And in fact, the wife and I had a pencil. We were doing a budget, you know. I can get a little bit from this company, a little bit from that company I was with. And then all of a sudden, here we are back in full swing, even bigger than I've ever been.
Now, would it be difficult to explain, because over the years, an artist records for many, many different recording companies, and then suddenly somebody gets an idea like this. Yeah. Now, do they have to go to those recording companies and buy up those masters before they can release this record?
Really, all of my masters are on two companies. I started out in 1948. I cut my first record in 1949 on RCA Victor. Mm-hmm. And then I moved over to Imperial Label, which was bought out by Liberty and UA, and everything for the past 25 years has been on UA,
United
two companies,
Artists,
really, uh-huh. On United Artists, and so Suffolk Marketing just went to UA and said we want to look at Whitman's catalog.
Now, what has this done to your personal appearance agenda? I mean, are you in demand now to play everywhere?
It has really came up. As a matter of fact, we'll be in Milwaukee next week. We're all over the place. We could be in Hawaii. I could be on a Mike Douglas show sometime.
Now, how do you travel? Do you have your own bus?
Well, no, I fly. I flew out here. And
you fly yourself?
No, I don't. I don't.
Well, you just fly commercial.
No, I'm back in the back holding on. I don't get up
like the rest of us, the white knuckles. Yeah. Yes. Can you teach somebody at some? Now, in this, I'm not making this up. It's like what you were showing me, Jake. I love to do things like that. But also, would like to know how to yodel. And it's not easy for singers to yodel.
No, it's one of the hardest things to teach because I don't know where it comes from.
Just see how many people here can do it. You show us, and then we'll start over there with John and see if he can. Listen to this now.
I mean, it's I don't know where it comes from.
You know something? I saw Jake get hit with a low shot in one of his fights. He did that very, made that very same sound. No. Go ahead, John.
Yoli.
Very good.
Thank you.
Again.
No. Give it a shot.
I can't.
Give it a shot.
A shot.
What do you do? You have to get something to click down there?
Well, if you think about it, you can do it.
I remember you.
Are you thinking about it?
I'm thinking, I can't do it.
Yeah, if you think about it,
I remember you.
Can't do it.
No,
there's no click. It's got to be a click.
It's got to be just, well, it's there. I've always had it.
Your audience is waiting, Lee. You have no idea what this is going to do for your career.
I have an idea.
You'll get your chance.
On my feet, so to speak. Yes.
Are you thinking about it?
You don't think about it.
No, you don't think about it.
So, this is why I'm not doing voiceovers.
Here's Jake's chance. The raging bird.
No, give me one. Come on, Jake. Can you do it?
We're going to be back with Dallas producer Lee Rich, right?
Welcome back to the show. Stephen King is on the show tonight, also Carol Leifer. And my first guest started his singing career in 1948. He has since become a major recording star in England and other countries around the world. In the United States, however, he was virtually unknown until a merchandise company offered a collection of his greatest hits on television. And as they say, the rest is history. Please welcome Slim Whitman.
Once I had a secret love that lived within the heart of me. All too soon my secret love became impatient to be free. The way that dreamers often do, just how wonderful you are, and why I'm so in love with you. Now my heart's an open door, and my secret love's no secret anymore. Now my heart's an open door. And my secret love's no secret anymore. Now my secret love's no secret anymore.
Welcome back to the show. Slim Whitman is here. Terrific, by the way. It was
Thank you
wonderful.
Very much.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Great song.
I don't know where to begin. You're just like the American dream come true, I guess. You started.
I hope so.
you started in this country as a country western singer years ago.
Yeah, I started in 1948.
And you went to England.
England in 1956.
And became a huge star there.
It was very good there, but it was very good here before it was good there.
I see.
It started really in 1952 with songs like the one I just sang, Secret Love, and Rosemary and Your Love Call, and then it went on to England.
Yeah, now it says here, the statistic, that in England you sold more records than the Beatles and Elvis Presley.
Well, it's... as far as selling more records than Elvis and the Beatles, that's not exact. The way it states, I think, on television, I think that's where that came from. It states that that this artist had the number one record longer than any other artist in the world, including Elvis and the Beatles. Mm-hmm. It was
what record was that?
It was Rosemary.
And how long was that the number one record?
It was 11 consecutive weeks in 1956. It's still there as the longest record in British history. It's in the Guinness Book of Records, and I think that's what that's all about.
But it seems to me that the real stepping stone, the breakthrough for you, was the television commercial.
The power of television.
That's right. How did that begin? How did that happen?
Well, I was sitting at home in Florida. I live in Florida with my family, and one day the phone rang about 2.5 years ago. The marketing company, had leased the tracks, I think 20 tracks from Capitol Records in California. They were going on television and wanted to know if I would do the commercial, and heck, I've watched all these album commercials. That didn't excite me any. I said, well, I don't know. I don't think I want to do it. And my son, which is here, Byron, my son is running somewhere. He's my bodyguard.
Bodyguard?
Yeah, he's a big guy. He's about 6'4", and I bring him around. He sings a little too. Yeah. We'll talk about that later.
Do you do you have groupies and so forth that he?
Well, he's part of my show, really, and he came with me today. But then he says, hey, well, you haven't got anything to lose. You haven't sold a record in the United States in 10 years. Why don't you go do it? And that was the way it started. I did. I went to Pittsburgh and did the commercial, and I said, when's it coming out? Mm-hmm. They said, when it passes the test market. Mm-hmm. I said, I haven't sold a record in 10 years. You want me to pass the test market?
Yeah.
But it did. It passed with flying colors, and once they found out they had a hit on their hands, they really worked, and I'm gonna congratulate them, because a lot of people, they only go so far with the record and quit, but they went all the way. They went from here to Hawaii, Alaska, and the whole United States, even back last to England.
So now you're, let me ask you this, you get a lot of money from those record sales?
Well, I hope I do. I haven't yet.
Haven't yet. But as a result of the record sales, you became popular again.
Well, that's the reason I'm here, really, because of that.
Yeah. When you started out, you knew, I guess you helped Elvis Presley get a job on a...
Well, Elvis, in fact, I played Memphis in the early 50s, I think 55. And there was a young fellow that he put on the show. He just came on the show.
What show was that?
It was in Memphis Auditorium. We played the Memphis Auditorium. And they said, we got a young fella, we want to just put on the show for a couple numbers and get him off of there. But once he got on, we couldn't get him off.
Mm-hmm.
See, and when I got back to Louisiana, I was on the Louisiana Hayride then. And I said, there's a young guy in Memphis that is doing pretty well. And ask a guy who knows. I wasn't even able to sing after he got off stage.
Yeah.
And that's when he went to Louisiana Hayride, and we toured together. And the fella that became his manager, Colonel Tom, was handling another act then. At the end of that tour, he had dropped the other act and got Elvis. That's where it started.
Tell me, how does a person go about yodeling?
Well,
I mean, that is sort of your signature or trademark or...
Yeah, I've been asked about little things I did on Secret Love. And
can you do one here or...
Una paloma blanca, I'm like a bird in the sky. But, it's something you have to born with. They ask me all the time if I knew when I learned to yodel. I don't remember.
Don't remember.
It was there all the time.
But it's now your trademark in the
records. If I go on stage and not do it, then I might as well go home.
People are disappointed, surely. Stay where you are, if you will, Mr. Whitman. Mm-hmm. We'll be right back to continue talking with Gene. Thank you, Paul. Slim Whitman is here. Who buys these records? You have fans from the old days now, and then I guess you're creating a new following.
I think the fans from the old days, the ones that brought the early Secret Loves, are the ones that really started this thing back, mm-hmm. and buying the songs like Mr. Songman, and the book that we have out, and it's titled Mr. Songman. It's put out by the Brethren Press in Elgin, Illinois, and in fact, it's got the same suit, and the album proves one thing. I do have another suit.
Boy, that is a suit you got there. I've been sitting here. Could I try on the jacket?
Yeah. Why not?
Is this an expensive garment, Slim? Whoa.
Yes, it is. Be careful.
Wait a minute. Let me...
Hey, how about that?
Looks well. Does well.
Now, before we bring out Mayor Koch to talk about the transit strike, this is a lovely garment. I guess now don't you have these specially made? I guess, huh?
Yes.
Yeah.
In Nashville.
Yeah. This must be a real kick for you.
It is.
This your renewed success and stuff.
Yeah, I've had more fun than I've ever had, really.
Yeah, terrific. I thank you very much for being here, Slim. It was a pleasure meeting you.
Coat, I'd like to have my coat back.
I'll give you your coat back. Right. Slim Whitman, ladies and gentlemen. Let me... back. We're going to take a look at some new commemorative stamps. Stephen King will be here and Carol Leifer.
New York, the city that reminds you not to leave the cap off your felt-tip pen overnight, or the pen will dry up, so be careful. It's Late Night with David Letterman. Tonight, singers Slim Whitman, comedian Elaine Boosler, actress Candy Clark, and it's Bob Rooney Day.
I think here would be a good time to point out that in high school, Bob was selected as most likely to be picked out of a lineup. Now, my next guest is the man responsible for making the yodel popular again, and thank heavens he did. Making a return appearance on this program, it's a pleasure on Bob Rooney Day to welcome Slim Whitman.
Lies rigged and ready in the harbor. Tomorrow for old England she sails. Far away from your land of endless sunshine to my land full of rainy skies and gale. And I shall be aboard that ship tomorrow. Though my eyes are full of tears at this farewell. For you are beautiful, I have loved you dearly, more dearly than a spoken word to tell. For you are beautiful, I have loved you dearly, more dearly than a spoken word to tell. Thank you.
blazing. And the taste of war I know so very well. Even now I see the foreign flag raising, their guns on fire as we sail into hell. I have no fear of death that brings no sorrow, but our bitter will be the last farewell. These islands, in leaving waves that brought me once to thee. Should I return safe home again to England, I shall watch the English bistro to the death. For you are beautiful, I have loved you dearly, more dearly than a spoken word to tell. Oh, you are beautiful. I have loved you dearly, more dearly than a spoken word to tell.
To the show, and we're very excited because Slim Whitman is back with us and back again on Bob Rooney Night. Later in the program, we have a clip from this year's Bob Rooney pageant. Candy Clark will also be joining us, and Ms. Elaine Boozler will be here. Slim, thanks for being here. How long have you known Bob?
About 5 minutes.
Yeah. Now, the last time you were here, we talked about your career before music. You played a little minor league baseball.
Yeah, a little baseball, a little shipyard, and then into music business.
You're also a meat packer, right?
Yeah, I was.
Now, define that term for us. A lot of people throw it around, but few people really know. know what it means.
In the early days, when I first got married, this is my 42nd year as being married to the same girl, Jerry.
42 years. 42 years.
And when we got married in 1941, I was in the packing house. Uh-huh. I was running the sausage grinder that made the links.
Ooh,
yeah.
And what goes in that comes out links? Anything you can talk about?
No.
Yeah. is it true that you hold the record for the longest sustained yodel?
I do.
I don't know. Does that ring a bell with you?
Well, really, there was a good friend of mine, Elton Britt, had a record called Chime Bells, and the record company called me one day, Imperial Records back then, which is no longer there, but they said, why don't you do Chime Bells? I said, well, if you do Chime Bells, you've got to top the other record, or there's no use doing it. So I think the record was, with Elton, was about 30 seconds, and we did 45 seconds.
45 seconds, one yodel.
One long, sustained yodel. But don't ask me to do it tonight, because that was years ago.
Yeah. Can you do that for us tonight?
No.
Now,
now. I'd be ashamed to disappoint Bob Rooney, though.
I'm not. I'm not ashamed.
No, you gotta have your you gotta have your vocal cords.
You gotta be in good shape, and you gotta be 20 years younger.
And you can't do a little yodel for us, a small one.
Una paloma blanca, I'm like a bird in the sky.
Yeah, that's all. That's great. That's great. Nice to have you back, Slim. Nice to see you.
It's good to be back.
And actually, you can buy your records in stores, can't you?
I hope so.
Yeah. People think that you can just order them through the...
Yeah. As a matter of fact, this is my 35th year in show business, and I just signed another couple of years with CBS Records.
Hey, how about that?
And it proves you are doing something right, or they wouldn't sign.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Well, listen, thanks again for being here, Slim. Stay right where you are. We got some other business to tend to. Stay right there. Kind of hayride.
When Webb left the show, again, another artist became superstar. It was a question among the acts, who's going to be the next big one?
I was doing a show in Nashville in 1949-50, and the show folded. I was out of a job, and my manager knew that there was an opening in Shreveport with Liz and Hayride. I didn't see how we could live on $50 a week. But Hank Williams had just left, and he had about the biggest record he ever had on this show. And so the wife and I and my manager at the time said, okay, if Hank Williams could do it, maybe you can do it.
I played a couple of shows with him once. I remember we played Vivian, Louisiana. Made 75 cents. They might kill me for telling that.
When I went to the Louisiana Hayride, I was not a big artist. I had four records, and none of them had sold over 4,000 records. But they said, just keep plugging away. One day you will have a big record.
When I'm calling you. And he'd practice that thing an hour. He'd go back home and practice. He'd start in a low key and then work himself up to the key where he was going to do the song in.
He was a unique, different style and type of talent. And very quiet and reserved type. But I noticed he got a tremendous response. And that, well, it wasn't what you could consider basically traditional in those days.
Now, whether it was a style or whether it was Slim voice or what, but Arthur Q. Lewis said, if you like to hear a coyote howl at the moon, then you'd like Slim Whitman. And the other one said, I think it's that Hawaiian guitar that the record has sold a million and nobody else has ever sold it. I don't know why, and don't really care. There was a million people liked it, and I'm glad to be a little part of pleasing them.
Kenny Lovecall had some steel guitar, which the other steel guitar players call errors. They went way up. I would be up in a high register. The steel guitar player would be up in a high register with me. And so that style was created on the Louisiana Hayride, but as a mistake. It was something I heard that wasn't supposed to be there. And I asked the guitar player afterward, I said, what did you do on that song? He says, I don't really know. I said, whatever you did, do it again. And that's the way we started. I have a soft place in my heart for the Hayride. I spent a lot of good years there. The biggest records I ever had were cut in Shreveport. I'm still cutting records today, but it's hard to get a record as big as I had back then.
Indian Love Call sold over 2 million singles. Slim Whitman was the first Hayride graduate to break with tradition. He built an independent recording career instead of going to the Grand Ole Opry. But the Whitman sound became part of the Hayride legend. People started watching the sidemen, the backup musicians who influenced the artist's style and the show's flavor.
A fan who's planning out his own t-shirts tonight, the host of Nashville Now, Ralph Emery.
On that line, if you please, ladies and gentlemen, Slim Whitman.
Be sure it's true when you say I love you. It's a sin to tell a lie. Millions of hearts have been broken just because these words were spoken. I love you, yes I do.
Welcome back to our show.
Yeah, good to be back, Jimmy.
I think they want you to sit down here, Slim, and hook that right into your navel. Yes.
Right.
Would you take this, sir? Yes.
You guys have something in common. Did you know
There's
that?
There's nothing common about either one of us.
No,
what do you want?
I'm not. I don't know.
You used to work in a meatpacking plant.
Yes, I did.
And you did, too.
As a matter of fact, he still is.
That's right. Yeah. I got to find something I can do, you know.
Where'd you do this?
Well, in Tampa, Florida, where I grew up. In fact, I was in the packing house when I got married.
Did you make sausage?
Yeah, we made sausage, and I lost the end off of a finger, and that's when I moved into something else.
They say you never know what goes in that sausage,
don't
they?
Was the freshest of the day.
Huh?
It was the best of the day, the end.
Boy, know? I want to tell you one thing. I just turned down a line right here that would have made this place a bowling alley tomorrow. I was so nice. I'd like her hand because I was brilliant. Because it was dirty, what it was.
Mr. Dean.
I know.
I appreciate your containing yourself. I know.
You know, you kid about that, and I'll tell you something. We have got the only sausage plant that I know of in the entire world, and I know in the United States, that has a plate glass window where anybody at any time, no setup tours, can walk in off of the street and see what's going into the product that they take home. We do things well, and we are proud of what we do, and it's the finest quality that is made in the world. So
I knew he'd get a plug in.
Well, we sell more of it than anybody in the United States.
Who was here a while back and it said Slim Whitman was my mailman? It was Merle Kilgore.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I'm still a mailman.
God, I hope so. With that jacket, we can never be sure.
Yeah, it's...
Where were you a mailman?
In Shreveport. In fact, when I left, I was here in Nashville in 1949, and I lost that job, and I headed for Shreveport, and I had a wife and daughter then, no son. Byron wasn't born then, but on the money they offered me of $18 a week in Shreveport, I couldn't actually eat too high on the hog, you might say,
Ain't a straight man left in the world nowhere, you know.
Are you telling me you went down to the Louisiana hayride?
Yeah, the hayride. I was a member of the hayride, but I could not, you might say, eat too well on $18 a week. So I went to the post office, and I was a postman. I was bit by as many dogs as any other guy in the post office.
Did you carry a stick?
Yeah.
The
bag was...
carry a stick to beat them off.
The stick of the bag, yeah, the bag was real good doing that. But yeah. It was a lifesaver. Mail carrying really was... it was real good until Indian Love Call came along and that sort of thing.
What did they pay a mailman in 1949?
Between the Louisiana hayride and the post office, I think I was making $50 a week.
1949?
Yeah.
That wasn't too bad.
Well, it was actually so much money, the wife and I had never seen that much money. And she kept, the first paycheck, she put half under her pillow, and I put half under mine.
You're kidding?
Yeah.
Why?
It was keep the people from robbing us.
May I inject one serious thing? You know, the son of a gun sings as good as he ever did.
Was he on the...
Did you really
that's
do?
That's debatable, yeah.
No, you really do. I'd hate to try to hit one of them high notes. What?
Did you have him on the old Jimmy Dean show?
No.
No, he didn't.
He was out of the country.
Well, no, I wasn't. I was around, but I wasn't there. I was invited.
Well, nobody asked me to ask
yeah,
you.
Nobody asked me to be there.
Don't let me get into this.
I was never on the Jimmy Dean show. That's the reason it went off.
Well, I don't know what it is. I mean, now that's the reason we stayed on for 3 years.
Okay. Well, I think we'll interrupt this debate. We'll be back in a moment to continue with Nashville Now.
I know what you're going to do, but I just thought, do you know what you get if you cross an elephant and a kangaroo?
What?
You get potholes all over Australia. See what
I got you.
The audience said, I'll explain them later. I'm just sat there and pick your nose. It's wonderful.
Will you hush?
All right.
We're going to bring on another singer that is very close to Slim Whitman. As a matter of fact, it is his son, Byron Whitman. And they're going to sing together an old tune called When My Blue Moon Turns to Gold Again. Here are Slim and Byron Whitman.
Memories that linger in my heart. Memories that make my heart run cold. But someday they'll live again, sweetheart. And my blue moon again will turn to gold. Those lips that used to thrill me so. Your kisses were meant for only me. And my dreams, they live again, sweetheart. But my golden moon is just a memory. When my blue moon turns to gold again, rainbow turns the clouds away. When my blue moon turns to gold again, you'll be back within my arms to stay. Stories ever told. Maybe we will live them all again. And my blue moon again will turn to gold. When my blue moon turns to gold again. When the rainbow turns the clouds away. When my blue moon turns to gold again. You'll be back within my arms to stay. Thank you.
that. We'll take another break. We'll be right back to Nashville Now right after this.
Caller, music. Hi, Doug.
Jim, Slim, what is the Slim Whitman Appreciation Society of the United States?
The United States, it's basically the same thing as a fan club. Yeah, that's me in the bathrobe on Christmas morning. And they're in, actually it originates in Tucson, Arizona.
I assume you're being a very popular fellow overseas. They have another appreciation society.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, it started overseas in Sheffield, up north of London. And then it spread to the United States. Now there is a branch in the United States, the Appreciation Society of the United States, it's called, which is what it says on the top, I guess. And it says on the button that Jimmy Dean is holding it. It says, Get Slim. And on March the 30th, in Jacksonville, Florida, we are putting on a show in Jacksonville, Florida. So everybody in Jacksonville, you be sure and be in Jacksonville on March the 30th and get Slim.
Where are you appearing?
In a Civic Auditorium in Jacksonville.
This says the only officially sanctioned fan club in the United States. Are there some unofficially sanctioned?
Yeah, we have several hundred members in Cleveland, have 400 or 500 in Pittsburgh, and it's scattered all around, but the official is the one you're holding.
How do you join? How do you join?
How you join? I haven't joined yet.
This may come as a shock to you, but I haven't either.
Well,
I'm sure it's worthwhile, and I'd like to.
You're very worthwhile.
Yeah, yeah, I'll do it, yeah.
But the information, I think, is on the pamphlet that you're holding.
The president is Lauren R. Knapp.
Knapp,
of Tucson, Arizona.
Yeah, and his brother, Taker.
Huh?
See, take a nap, you see.
Yes, I caught that.
But if they want to join the Appreciation Society of the United States, if Jimmy will read my address in Tucson, Arizona, then...
I'm just looking between the jacket and the bathroom.
No, address.
Your tailor's got a hell of a sense of humor. You know that, I'll tell you. The address?
Address.
Is he going to plug anything else?
I just read that.
The address.
Send $8 to Blue Earth, Minnesota. No. It's at 1002 West Thumber.
No, Thurber.
Put your glasses back on.
Tucson, Arizona, 85705 USA. Well, where else?
There you
Tucson,
have it.
Tucson, Arizona.
There
That's
you have
got it.
It.
All right.
And March the 30th in Jacksonville, Florida.
All right. Now
heavens.
We're through plugging. You did 15 minutes on the sausage. You
no.
Can we have Lloyd Lindreth back tonight. Lloyd, bring you another tune, my friends. He said as he changed the subject, here again is Slim Whitman. All right, do you have a question?
Yeah, I want to talk to Slim Whitman.
Okay, go ahead.
Slim, how long have you been singing country music?
Actually, as long as I've been in the business, which is 36 years.
What was your first record?
First record, I'm Casting My Lasso Toward the Sky. It was backed with I'll Do As Much For You Someday. And the second record was Birmingham Jail. That's all I know.
You sell a lot of them?
No. Mm-hmm. We didn't sell many. That's the reason I moved to another record company.
Okay. I believe that answers your question.
Could I have an autographed picture of him?
Oh.
She would like to know.
Yes, I don't happen to have one with me.
How could she write to you,
Mr.
Slim?
Mr. Blazer here. That's about all I got.
Slim,
write to that fan club address.
Yeah, the address again. Where's the address?
Get out of here, Slim, with your address. We've plugged all we're going to plug. No more sausage or fan
Auditorium Jacksonville, March 30. That's all right.
How could she write to you? Instead of the fan club?
Oh, that address is 1002 Thurber Street, in Tucson, Arizona. I don't know what the zip is.
Will you get it?
Well, it might come to me, but it goes to Arizona first. But the young lady wants a picture, right?
Right.
He figured that out. Isn't that wonderful? You'll hear from him in December.
Yeah. All right.
Yes, if she would write to the fan club, and
I'll tell you what, I will
autograph pictures,
this, honey.
I will stack them.
If you write to me at Gear of the Nashville Network, we'll see if we can get you one, okay?
There you are. Well, that answers that.
Yes. My son and I have been trying for about a year and a half. We just now got through. This is the first time I got through.
Byron, you've hardly had a word on this show tonight. Anybody you want to say hello to? Anything you want to say tonight?
Yeah, I'd like to say, hi, Mom.
Okay. Byron's going to sing the next song here as Nashville Now continues with this pretty song called Understanding.
Have a clue.